Good morning to all the viewers. So last session we had a discussion on capital gains, and now we are in fifth head, income from other sources. Even though the topic name is other sources, many valuable provisions like gift, deemed dividend, taxability of compensations were being discussed in this chapter. So with no loss of time, let us begin our discussion with the chapter income from other sources. For every head of income, we are beginning with charging section. Salary, section 15, house property, section 22, PGBP, section 28, capital gain, 45, and now coming to other sources, it's 56. So in section 56, now we are going to learn the charging section. Since other sources also had charging section, many might feel that when any income is not chargeable in any head, it shall be automatically get taxed under the head income from other sources. It is not the correct interpretation. First, we need to check the income definition. Let me give an example. If 25 lakhs has been received by a person on sale of his one of the kidney, he has donated kidney to one of the patient for which they have given him a compensation of 25 lakhs. Whether this 25 lakhs is taxable or not is the question. When any kidney has been donated but not for a free charge, he has taken 25 lakhs and contributed one of his kidney to other person. In this case, this 25 lakhs, whether is it taxable under the head salary? No, there is no employer and employee relationship. This is not a house property, and this is not the business of the SSC, and kidney is not the capital asset, and hence it is not chargeable under any of the heads of income. So the thing that comes into our mind is, since the income is not chargeable under these four heads, it may be taxable under the head income from other sources. But this is not the criteria. This 25 lakhs even is not taxable under the head income from other sources also. First of all, it has to be included in definition of the term. The income has been defined in section 2 subsection 24, where the provisions which were specified in charging section of other sources were only taxable. So you have to delete that thing from your mind that when any income is not chargeable under other heads, it is automatically chargeable under the head under other sources. This is not the correct way of interpretation. First of all, it has to be specified in the income definition. And if it was not included under any head of income, then we have to compare income from other sources. So since other sources is also head of income and it also has a charging section, so it has to be interpreted in the manner which was specified. So charging section consists of two subsections, subsection 1 and subsection 2. Subsection 1 is general charging section. Subsection 2 is specific. Each item will be discussed in a specific manner in subsection 2 and in a general manner in subsection 1. So coming to subsection 1, conditions to be satisfied to tax any income under this head. First, such receipt must be income. This is very important aspect. So first, such receipt must be income. Whenever it is an income, then only the expenditure incurred can be, it can be taxable under various heads of income. So first of all, in order to tax an income under the head income from other sources, the first thing to be kept in mind is such receipt must be income is the first point. And coming to second point, such income must not be exempt. If it is an exempted income, it is not taxable under any head also. Even in other sources also, it is not taxable. So the income must be a taxable income. It must be an income, first point. It must be a taxable income, and it must not be charged under other heads of income. Then only we have to come to income from other sources. Next, coming to the other thing, according to section 56, we have two subsections. Subsection 1 is general and subsection 2 is specific. Now coming to the specific provisions of income from other sources, the first concept that was specified here is dividends. So now let us learn the taxability of dividends in the hands of the shareholders. सर एक्चुअली डिविडेंड इफ आई कैटेगराइज इनटू टू पार्ट्स डिविडेंड फ्रॉम कंपनीज ओके एंड डिविडेंड फ्रॉम म्यूचुअल फंड्स. डिविडेंड फ्रॉम म्यूचुअल फंड इज फुल्ली एग्जेम्प्ट अंडर सेक्शन 10 सब सेक्शन 35. द लिमिट ऑफ 10 लैक्स should not be interpreted in section 10 subsection 35. So entire dividend received from mutual fund is fully exempted under section 10 subsection 35 because the mutual fund at the time of the distribution is going to pay tax on the distributed profits. We are going to learn it in assessment of other persons, trust, securitization trust. In that way only we will discuss assessment of mutual fund also in that day. So now coming to the matter, income from mutual fund, dividend from mutual fund is fully exempted under section 10 subsection 35. So coming to first part, companies, in case of companies, dividend from companies, dividend received from companies, okay, dividend received from companies. Here I am going to divide it into two parts, dividend received from Indian company or dividend received from foreign company. Dividend received from foreign company is always taxable under the head income from other sources. But if dividend is received from Indian company, in such a case, if the dividend is received by, dividend is paid by an Indian company, and the dividend if it is received by another Indian company, company A has invested in company B and is going to receive the dividend. So if dividend is received by Indian company or received by trust or received by education institutes or hospitals who are claiming exemption under section 1023C. This exemption under section 1023C we are going to deal in one of the chapter assessment of trust at a later point of time. Now coming to the subject, in these three cases, if dividend is received by them, then such dividend is exempted. Then such dividend is exempted under section 1034. Fully exempted. The limit of 10 lakhs is not applicable for dividend received by Indian company or charitable trust which is registered under section 12AA or education institutes and hospitals who were claiming exemption under section 1023C. If they are going to receive dividend from Indian companies, it is fully exempt under section 1034. And if the dividend is received by others, here others means nothing but individual, HUF, partnership firm, if they are going to receive the dividend, in this case aggregate dividend from all the companies, from all the Indian companies, we have to make the aggregate dividend. If this aggregate dividend less than or equal to 10 lakhs, then it is exempt under section 10 subsection 34. But if the aggregate dividend from all the companies has exceeded 10 lakhs, then up to 10 lakhs we can claim exemption under section 1034. Greater than 10 lakhs, in excess of 10 lakhs received aggregate dividend is taxable at the rate 10% under section 115 BBDA. So I think this provisions of dividend is very clear. Dividend from mutual fund, irrespective of the limit, it is fully exempt under section 10 subsection 35. But dividend received from Indian dividend received from companies, I have bifurcated into two categories, Indian company and foreign company. So dividend received from Indian company, received by Indian company or charitable trust or education institutes claiming exemption under 1023 is fully exempt under section 1034. And coming to second part, if dividend is received by others, that means individual, HUF, partnership firm, to the extent of aggregate dividend of 10 lakhs, exemption can be claimed under section 1034. And aggregate dividend exceeding 10 lakhs, to the extent of 10 lakhs exemption can be claimed under 1034, greater than 10 lakhs is taxable under section 115 BBDA at the rate 10%. So I think this concept of dividend is very clear. So coming to our discussion, this is the first point regarding dividends. And dividend should also be discussed from company point of view also regarding dividend distribution tax. So let me clarify this, because dividend includes a deemed dividend under section 222 A to E also. So that deemed dividend also we are going to have a discussion. Okay, so let me continue this. At that point of time, I shall also clarify you the concept of deemed dividend also. Why the dividend is being exempted under 1034 is, company at the time of distributing the dividend, it is liable to pay dividend distribution tax. How to compute dividend distribution tax? Those are all the things now we are going to get it clarified, but after some time. Now coming to our discussion, if we continue, 1B, casual incomes. The thing that was specified here is casual incomes. That means without any effort of the individual. That effort may be based on luck. For example, winning from lotteries, crossword puzzles. Sir, crossword puzzles requires knowledge levels also, but it has been termed as casual income only. So what is the importance of this casual income? All these casual incomes were liable to tax at the rate 30% without any reduction of expenses and without any set off of the losses. Without any set off of losses and without reduction of expenses, these casual incomes were liable to tax at the rate 30% straight away. And coming to next thing, even basic exemption limit also cannot be claimed out of such casual incomes. And winning from races, card games, other games, even TV game shows and entertainment programs. In TV game show, Kaun Banega Karodpati, if a person is going to win 50 lakhs or 1 crore, whether 1 crore shall be paid to such person? Answer is no. Out of such 1 crore, they are going to deduct TDS at the rate 30%. Sir, Kaun Banega Karodpati means it's completely intellectual knowledge. Such winning, whether it can be termed as casual income? Yes. All the entertainment shows which were given in television, if you are going to win, it shall be treated as casual income only. And such casual incomes were liable to straight away tax at the rate 30%. So coming to point 1C, regarding employees' contribution towards staff welfare scheme. We have already discussed in the concept of, we have already made a discussion in profit from business or profession, profits and gains from business or profession, that employees' contribution has to be deposited by employer within the due date of relevant act. Within the due date of relevant act, it has to be deposited. So ESI, PF, within the due date specified in such act, such provident fund contribution of employee has to be deposited. If employee's contribution is not deposited within the due date of the relevant act, it shall be treated as the income of the SSE. That means it shall be added back. If it was not added under the head PGBP, then we are going to add it under the head income from other sources. So if this item has already been considered in PGBP, now you need not worry. If you are not going to add it under head PGBP, in such a case, we have to consider here. Okay, next. Coming to interest on securities, like debenture interest. If debentures were held as stock in trade, then debenture interest is taxable under head PGBP only, because the thing that was specified here is, if it is not chargeable to head under the head PGBP, if debenture is a stock in trade, then the dividend, then the interest received out of such debenture and bonds shall be taxable under the head PGBP. But if it held as an investment, then the interest received out of the debentures shall be taxable under the head income from other sources, is the conclusion. Okay, coming to second part, higher income of plant, machinery and furniture. Sir, if plant and machinery and furniture letting itself is our business, Pandal and Shamiana contract, letting out of furniture and plant and machinery itself is our business, then rent received out of such plant and machinery and furniture is taxable under the head PGBP only. But if it is not the course of business, generally we have let out our plant and machinery and furniture on a rent basis, which is not the regular activity we are going to do. In such cases, this item shall be taxable under the head other sources. That means if it is not chargeable under the head PGBP, if this is the business activity, then it is taxable under the head PGBP. If it is not the business activity, then it is taxable under the head income from other sources. So coming to third point, higher income of plant, machinery and furniture along with building. So if you remember our discussion with income from house property, if there is composite rent, that means where building rent includes rent for other facilities also, this is called as compounding rent. In case of compounding rent, composite rent, where building rent and other facilities rent is separable, then building rent is taxable under head house property, other facilities rent is taxable under the head other sources. But if building rent and other facilities rent is inseparable, if a theater has been let out, theater is a building, if it was let out along with furniture and equipment for 5 lakhs per month, where rental agreement has not bifurcated the building rent and other facilities rent, in such a case, entire rent, the composite rent, fully taxable under the head other sources only, but not under the head house property, where it is inseparable. Entire income is taxable under the head other sources. If this is the business activity, then it is taxable under the head. If this is the business activity, then it is taxable under the head PGBP. If this is not the business activity, then it is taxable under the head income from other sources is the conclusion. Okay. Now coming to point number 5. Key man insurance policy receipts. The thing that was specified here is key man insurance policy receipts. In day 2 itself, when I have started with the salary and also discussed it in the PGBP chapter also, key man insurance policy premium paid by employer can be claimed as deduction by employer under section 37. That means it is allowable as business expense. But now coming to the discussion, receipt upon maturity or termination. In such a case, if key man insurance maturity receipt is received by employee during employment or after employment, it is taxable under the head salary if it was received by employee. And if this key man insurance policy receipts were received by employer and in hands of employer, it is taxable under the head PGBP. Now coming to other sources, if this key man insurance policy maturity receipts were received by family members of employee upon death of employee, if this maturity amount is received by family members of employee, then in the hands of family members, it is taxable under the head income from other sources. So based upon the person who is receiving this, we have to conclude the matter. Okay. Now coming to point number 5. Here we have completed key man insurance policy. These are all the subsections which were specified in section 56 subsection 2. As we have already discussed that PGBP, other sources, we have section 56, charging section, two subsections. Subsection 1 is a general thing and subsection 2 is the specific charging section. Now we are with specific items, completed dividends, casual incomes and contributions. Now coming to closely held companies. In case of closely held companies, here there is a provision. Let me give a clarification. For examination point of view, and also since the members in practice generally have high private companies, so unlisted companies, this provision is very useful to all the chartered accountants and also students, IPCC and final level, everyone, this provision is very, very useful. Closely held company. Closely held company. Or unlisted companies or company in which public is not substantially interested. So all these three terms were one and the same. Wherever in the provisions of Income Tax Act, they use the term the company in which public is not substantially interested or closely held company, or unlisted companies means nothing but, in a simple manner, a private company is always a closely held company, and public company, if it is unlisted, then it is called as a closely held company. Private company, there is no concept of listing at all. So private companies shall also be unlisted. And in case of public companies, if it was listed, then it shall be termed as a company in which public is substantially interested. Only unlisted companies shall be called as a closely held company generally. So making it common, we can term this as, in a simple manner, as unlisted companies. So wherever the term the closely held company has been used, it means it refers to the companies in which public is not substantially invested. That means nothing but a unlisted company is the conclusion. Okay, so I think this provision is very clear. Now coming to our discussion, in case of a closely held company, that means unlisted companies, here they have given a provision that if unlisted companies issues shares at a premium, first condition is the shares must be issued at premium. So 10 rupees share might be issued for 100 rupees. This is called as the shares which were issued at premium. This is the face value and this is the issue price. In this case, 90 is called as securities premium. Like this, the first thing that was specified here is the shares must be issued at premium, first condition. And number two, it should exceed the fair market value of the asset, fair market value of the company. How to measure the fair market value of the company? Based on net assets value method, if we measure the share value of the company, the present market value of share is 50 rupees. Or for our example, let us take the fair market value present is 60 rupees. And now it has been given for 100 rupees. In this case, the difference is 40 rupees, which is in excess of fair market value. This 40 is taxable in the hands of closely held company under the head income from other sources is the conclusion. So even though the securities premium received is 90 rupees, 90 rupees is not taxable in the hands of the company. In the hands of the company, we are going to tax only 40 rupees. That means the price which exceeds the fair market value is 60 rupees and issue price is 100 rupees. Condition number one, it must be issued at a premium. Condition number two, it has to exceed the fair market value. In such a case, such excess amount is taxable under the head income from other sources. This provision is applicable only in case of closely held companies only is the conclusion. So by this we have completed clause 7b. And coming to clause 8, interest on compensation. Compensation is taxable under the head capital gain. If you remember, in last day we have discussed provisions of capital gain. Compensation or enhanced compensation is taxable in the hands of the recipient under the head capital gain upon acquisition of any land or building. But coming to here, if any enhanced compensation has been received along with interest, enhanced compensation is taxable under the head capital gain, and interest on such enhanced compensation is taxable under the head income from other sources. So interest is taxable under the head income from other sources. If it was clearly specified in the order that principal amount is 5 lakhs, interest is 1 lakh, in such a case, interest on such compensation is taxable under the head other sources. If no separate has been disclosed, that means total they have given 6 lakhs of compensation, in such a case entire 6 lakhs is taxable under head capital gain only. If it was bifurcated, then such interest is taxable under the head income from other sources is the conclusion. And this ninth point, we have already made a discussion in last session that advance money forfeited, the thing that was specified here is the advance money forfeited for transfer of a capital asset on or after 1/4/2014. Because before 1/4/2014, the thing we are going to do is the advance money forfeited will be reduced from the cost of acquisition and then indexation will be made. But with effect from 1/4/2014, the advance money forfeited shall be directly taxable under the head income from other sources is the conclusion. So now coming to 10th point, here we have the provision of gifts. gift also we are going to discuss in further pages. So let's keep it pending. As of now, just to remember, gift received in excess of 50,000 is taxable. This was regarding cash, mobile or immobile. Let us have a discussion today only at a later point of time. Now let me begin with the concept of dividend. Very, very important aspect from company's point of view. Let me begin with the concept of dividend. Dividend. If a company balance sheet, I am going to give in a T form. Practically, if they are going to prepare in horizontal, but for a easy understandable manner, I am going to present in a T form. If the share capital of the company is 200 lakhs, reserves and surplus is 300 lakhs, current liability is 100 lakhs. So total 600 lakhs. Coming to fixed assets, 250 lakhs. Investments, 150 lakhs. Current assets, 200 lakhs. A simple balance sheet, I am going to take it as an example. Now, since the company have reserves and surplus to the extent of 300 lakhs, if company distributes dividend out of such 300 lakhs, let me take an example. If the company distributes the dividend of 170 lakhs, now on this 170 lakhs, whether the company is liable to pay dividend distribution tax is the question. Sir, the screen will be visible to you in a very easy manner, but you need to watch the video at a quality of minimum 360p. Every day I am going to repeat the same thing. The screen is not clear is the query that was raised here, but it will be clear, sir. But you need to watch the video in a minimum 360p quality. Okay. Now coming to our discussion. If the company is going to pay the dividend of 170 lakhs, in such a case, the company is liable to pay dividend distribution tax at the rate 15% plus surcharge at the rate 12% plus health and education cess at the rate 4%. On which item this tax is levyable? If the company distributes 170 lakhs dividend, whether dividend distribution tax of 15% attracts on 170 lakhs only? Answer is no. This 170 lakhs is the net dividend given by the company. What we need to do now is gross up the net dividend. That means the gross dividend, this dividend is equal to 85%. After dividend distribution tax, this is the net dividend payable by the company. Dividend distribution tax is payable on the gross dividend. And hence, now the gross dividend is 170 lakhs into 100 by 85. Because this 170 lakhs is equal to 85%. The gross dividend 100%, how much we need to make a calculation. 170 lakhs into 100 by 85 is the gross dividend received by the company. This is payable by the company. On this gross dividend, dividend distribution tax at the rate 15% must be calculated. So let me take an example. If for example, if this comes to 200 lakhs, on 200 lakhs, 15% dividend distribution tax means nothing but 30 lakhs. Okay. On this 30 lakhs, we need to levy surcharge at the rate 12%. This 12% surcharge is fixed. So it need not vary based on the total income. That is the income, total income of the company surcharge is different. This dividend surcharge is different. This surcharge has to be added even though the dividend payable is less than 1 crore. This surcharge is a mandatory surcharge. So coming to this 12% surcharge, we need to add here, and after adding this 12% of surcharge, and we need to add health and education cess at the rate 4%. Here comes the total dividend distribution tax payable by the company. That means dividend distribution tax is payable on the gross dividend is the conclusion. So coming to the point here, even though the company is distributing 170 lakhs of dividend, but company is liable to pay dividend distribution tax on the gross dividend. They are going to gross up the dividend and levy dividend distribution tax. So by this, the provision is very clear that it is very harsh on point of view of the company. Sir, actually, now Finance Act 2020 has deleted the provisions of dividend distribution tax and introduced the concept of TDS on dividend. our decision we are planning only on Finance Act 2019 basis, that means assessment year 2021, because now we are going to next file assessment 2021 returns, and for examination point of view also we need assessment year 2021 only. But this dividend distribution tax has been deleted in Finance Act 2020, and a concept of TDS has been introduced in this place. So it is a separate concept from next assessment year onwards. This discussion is only from point of view of assessment year 2021. So based on that, I am going to give you a conclusion that company, upon payment of dividend, dividend distribution tax is to be levied. So in order to eliminate such dividend distribution tax, company might have picked various alternatives. Company might have choose various alternatives for payment of dividend, but dividend distribution tax should not be levied. What are the various alternatives that the company may choose is, number one, sir, finally, I think this provision is very clear. I have now explained the concept of dividend distribution tax. And now, let me enter into the concept of deemed dividend. Here, the value of the investment is 150 lakhs. The company, if dividend is paid out of this 300 lakhs, there might be a chance to levy dividend distribution tax on the company. In order to avoid such a dividend distribution tax, the thing the company has thought of is to distribute this investment to the shareholders. Instead of distributing dividend, the company is distributing the assets. Here, asset is nothing but investment. This 150 lakh shall be distributed to the shareholder so that shareholder shall enjoy the benefits. So from shareholder point of view, shareholder will get satisfied. Instead of money, he is going to receive investment from the company. Company point of view, if dividend is distributed, dividend distribution tax shall be levied. But here, instead of dividend, company has distributed assets. So there might be a denotation that company need not pay dividend distribution tax. Like this, if dividend has been paid, company is liable to pay dividend distribution tax. In order to avoid such a dividend distribution tax, company have planned a alternative that investment of 50 lakhs shall be distributed instead of the dividend. So that dividend distribution tax might not be levied. In order to eradicate this, the government has introduced the provisions of deemed dividend under section 222. In place of dividend, if you are going to distribute assets also, it is called as deemed dividend under section 222A. Dividend distribution tax not only attracts on normal dividend, dividend distribution tax also attracts on deemed dividend also. So finally, in case of distribution of accumulated profits entailing the release of assets, whenever the accumulated profits were distributed by way of release of the asset, in such a case, it shall be treated as the deemed dividend is the conclusion. So finally, the provision is very clear. If this 150 lakhs is given by the company to the extent of accumulated profits, here accumulated profits is 300 lakhs. So if 150 lakhs has been distributed, in such a case, 150 lakhs is treated as deemed dividend, and that 150 lakhs is to be gross up, 150 lakhs into 100 by 85. On that, we are going to levy 15%, 12% and 4%. This is very clear. So 12% surcharge and 4% health and education cess. So if these two items were distributed by the company, 250 plus 150, if 400 lakhs is distributed by the company, then now deemed dividend under 222A is not 400 lakhs. It is to the extent of accumulated profit 300 lakhs only. If you consider here, to the extent of accumulated profits, has been used, the term that was used here is to the extent of accumulated profits. That means if 400 lakhs is distributed by the company, 400 lakhs value of assets, 400 lakhs is not called as deemed dividend. Deemed dividend shall be to the extent of 300 lakhs only, to the extent of accumulated profits. So by that, the provision is very clear that if the company, in place of dividend, if it is going to distribute the asset, that asset distribution to the extent of accumulated profits is called as deemed dividend, and company is liable to pay dividend distribution tax on such 240, to the extent of accumulated profits. Okay. So this provision is very clear regarding the first provision 222A, distribution of assets. So this alternative has been eliminated by way of introduction of section 222A. Now company has planned for another alternative, that to issue debentures to the equity shareholders. This equity shareholders have to receive dividend. Instead of dividend, the company issues debentures. This 300 lakhs shall be changed to 200 lakhs and 15% debentures, example, 15% debentures of 100 lakhs shall be issued. That means out of the reserves and surplus, if dividend is issued, dividend distribution tax might be levied. Now instead of dividend, the company is going to distribute debentures to the shareholders or preference shares to the shareholders. In such a case, if debentures or preference shares were allotted to the equity shareholders, in such a case, it indirectly amounts to dividend only. If normal dividend is paid, dividend distribution tax will get attracted. In place of dividend, if the company issues debentures and preference shares, then also it shall be treated as the deemed dividend. Deemed dividend under section 2, subsection 22, clause B. Distribution of debentures or deposit certificates or bonus shares to the preference shareholders is the conclusion. So I think this provision is also very clear. So company is going to frame various alternatives to avoid dividend distribution tax, and such alternatives were being eliminated by income tax department by way of introducing this deemed dividend. So we have completed 222A and 222B. Now coming to 222C. Distribution to shareholders on liquidation. The thing that was specified here is distribution to shareholders on liquidation. For example, if this company is liquidated, let me present back the items. This is 300 lakhs earlier. Okay, this is our original balance sheet. Now coming back to the terms. If this company is liquidated now, that means if the company is closed, the surplus assets goes to equity shareholders. If this company is closed, out of the 600 lakhs realization, 100 lakhs shall be, liability shall be cleared, and this 500 lakhs shall be paid to the shareholders. In this 500 lakhs, 300 lakhs is nothing but reserves and surplus. If dividend is distributed out of such reserves and surplus, dividend distribution tax arises. Now, upon liquidation, if this 300 lakhs shall also be paid to the shareholders, that means in an indirect manner, at the time of liquidation, the company is going to share reserves and surplus to the shareholders. And so, at the time of liquidation, to the extent of accumulated profits, if this company is liquidated, this 300 lakhs is called as deemed dividend under section 222C. And the shareholder surrenders his share and receives money from the company. There should not be double taxation. And so in last session capital gains also, if you remember our special case number 7 in capital gains, the fair market value of the asset received, we are going to reduce deemed dividend under 222C. I think this point is very clear now. Last session we have not discussed deemed dividend. So I have kept that point in pending. Now this provision is very clear. Before continuation of this point, let me come back to this provision, that in case of companies upon liquidation, sir, this concept is applicable for any company, private company, public company, listed, unlisted, any company, for all the companies, this concept of deemed dividend is applicable. So the share capital 200 lakhs is nothing but investment by the shareholders. In excess, they are going to receive nothing but reserves and surplus. Such reserves and surplus to the extent of accumulated profits at the time of liquidation of the company is called as deemed dividend, is the conclusion. So I think this provision is very clear. So upon liquidation also, to the extent of reserves and surplus, company is liable to pay dividend distribution tax, is the conclusion. Okay. Now let me come back. So coming to 222D. Reduction of share capital. Now this is the fourth alternative that was thought by the company. Instead of liquidation, now let us come back to example again. The same example, I am going to present it in five different forms. If in this balance sheet, the company, what the thing it is going to do is, instead of giving dividend out of this 300 lakhs, they are going to reduce share capital to 100 lakhs. And out of current assets, since cash is available, they are going to pay the dividend. That means, instead of reducing reserves and surplus, the share capital of 200 lakhs has been changed to 100 lakhs. The share capital has been reduced and current assets, cash available, if the cash is available, out of that, this 100 lakhs has been changed. So, the company, in place of distributing dividend, is going to reduce its share capital. This reduction of share capital is also called as deemed dividend. Sir, reduction of share capital is different from buyback of shares. Buyback of shares, we have made a discussion in last session itself that buyback of shares is completely taxable in the hands of the company only with effect from 5/7/2019. Last session in capital gains, we have already made a discussion on buyback of shares. The concept of buyback of shares is different from this reduction of share capital. Buyback is an exemption. Buyback is also one form of reduction of share capital, but this is an exception to the concept of deemed dividend. So, if the share capital 10 each shares were reduced to 5 each and such difference is paid to the shareholder, such reduction of share capital is nothing but a distribution of dividend only. It is called as deemed dividend under section 222D. So, we are deemed dividend, we have 5 provisions, out of which first provision is distribution of assets, allotment of debentures, distribution upon liquidation, and now coming to fourth point, distribution of shares on reduction of the share capital. So, we have discussed 4 different cases here. So, all these cases were applicable for all the companies. But now coming to fifth case, this fifth case is not applicable for listed companies. This fifth case is applicable only in case of a closely held company. This fifth case is applicable only for a closely held company. Sir, what do you mean by the term closely held? Today, in beginning itself, I have clarified that unlisted companies or company in which public is not substantially interested or closely held company were one and the same. Point number E, the thing that was discussed here is, if a closely held company gives loan to a shareholder, so now this is the balance sheet of a closely held company. Let me present back the values. So, based on the same example, we are continuing our discussion. If in this case, instead of this reserves and surplus, the company is going to give a loan or an advance to the shareholder out of his current assets, instead of giving dividend, the company is going to give loan to the shareholder. In such a case, this loan given is also called as the deemed dividend under section 222E. But this provision is applicable for closely held company. Generally, in private companies, in most of the cases, at the time of filing return of income also, in my client case also, I have verified this, that the directors generally draw the profits by way of loan. If director ledger account is being displayed in unsecured loans, it means in unsecured loans and advances given, not borrowed, given. If in company's balance sheet, if there is loans and advances column, that means company has given loan to a shareholder. Generally, director is also a shareholder. But to a shareholder who have at least 10% voting power, this 222E deemed dividend attracts when a loan or an advance is given to a beneficial owner of at least 10% voting power. So, finally, loan or advance given by a company to 10% voting power shareholder is called as deemed dividend. And the very, very most important thing to be kept in mind in this case is, normally on deemed dividend or normal dividend under section 222A, B, C, D, company is going to pay dividend distribution tax at the rate 15% only on gross dividend. But on deemed dividend under 222E, company is going to pay dividend distribution tax at the rate 30%. It's very typical task on part of the company. On normal dividend and deemed dividend under 222A to D, 15% tax only attracts. But on deemed dividend under section 222E, which is applicable to a closely held company, which has given loan and advance to a shareholder who has voting power of at least 10%. In such a case, 30% tax is payable straight away. The thing that was specified here is 30% tax without grossing up. In this case, if 50 lakhs advance is given to a shareholder with a voting power of 10%, in such a case, this 50 lakhs into 30% shall be payable. This dividend need not be grossed up. This dividend need not be grossed up. Here, 50 lakhs into 30% straight away company is liable to pay. Only normal dividend and 222A to D grossing up must be made. 222E need not be make into grossing up. In this case, 50 lakhs into 30%, 15 lakhs plus 12% surcharge plus 4% health and education cess is common. So, on 222E deemed dividend, company is liable to pay higher tax. And this dividend received by shareholder is fully exempt under section 1034. Now let me give a complete presentation from viewpoint of shareholder regarding deemed dividend and normal dividend. In this chart, the complete clarification we are going to get from viewpoint of shareholder. This chart is not from viewpoint of company. I am going to present this from viewpoint of shareholder. Here, coming to the first part, dividend. In dividend, the first part that was given here is the dividend received from domestic company is the first point. Is the dividend received from domestic company? No, no means nothing but dividend received from foreign company is fully taxable. I think this provision is very clear. Now coming to first part, yes, that means dividend received from Indian company. If this is a normal dividend or a deemed dividend. In deemed dividend, again we have bifurcated into 222A to D and 222E. Because on 222E dividend, company is going to pay higher tax of 30% tax, 12% surcharge and 4% cess. It is fully exempt in the hands of the shareholder. But if shareholder receives normal dividend and deemed dividend under 222D, both I have taken it into here, there to the extent of 10 lakhs, 1034 exemption can be claimed. In excess of 10 lakhs, a special tax rate of 10% shall be levied in this case. If dividend does not exceed 10 lakhs, then it is fully exempt. If aggregate dividend exceed 10 lakhs, then exemption can be claimed to the extent of 10 lakhs. And in excess of 10 lakhs, a special tax rate of 10% shall be levied. So I think this provision is very clear. Okay. So this is from viewpoint of the shareholder. From viewpoint of shareholder, aggregate dividend up to 10 lakhs need not be verified on deemed dividend under 222E, because on deemed dividend under 222E, company is going to pay higher taxes. So we need not bother regarding this concept. So let me continue our discussion. 222E, what are the circumstances in which 222E will get attracted? Number one, loan is given to a shareholder who is having voting power of at least 10%. Now coming to second part, this part I am going to give you a clarification by way of example. A Limited, Mr. B, C Limited. If Mr. B has 10% capital in B, A Limited and 20% capital in C Limited. If A Limited gives advance to B Limited, this is a deemed dividend under 222E. If C Limited gives advance to B Limited, Mr. B, this is also a deemed dividend under 222E, because minimum 10% voting power is already existed, and hence if Mr. B borrows loan, it shall be treated as deemed dividend to the extent of accumulated profits. But now comes into the question that if A Limited gives advance to C Limited, this is also a deemed dividend. Indirect way of lending. If Mr. B borrows loan, we shall automatically know from this first point itself that this is a deemed dividend. Now coming to point number B, loan is given to a concern loan is given to a concern. A limited has given loan to a concern C limited, in which shareholder having 10% voting power has substantial interest in a company. If Mr. B has substantial interest in C limited, if A limited, in which B has 10% voting power, gives advance to C limited, this advance is also called as deemed dividend. So loan is given to a concern in which shareholder referred in first point, that means 10% voting power, has substantial interest of 20% in C limited. In this case, if A limited gives any loan to C limited, this advance is also called as the deemed dividend, and on this advance also company is liable to pay 30% of tax. So the company, instead of giving dividend, they are going to give loan. Even though such loan is repaid back at a later point of time, this is not the criteria. Even though the loan has been repaid, this shall be treated as deemed dividend only, because the company business is not money lending business. If company business itself is money lending business, it is an exception. Here we are going to learn exceptions of deemed dividend, buyback of shares, and number two, advance made in the ordinary course of business. If the shareholder itself is creditor of the company also, for the purchase of stock, if any advance of 10 lakhs is given, and such creditor is also a shareholder of the company who has 10% voting power, in this case, advance has been given to purchase the material, not out of the profits. So if advance is given in the ordinary course of business, or money lending is the substantial business of the company, this is an exception. So finally, the thing I am going to conclude here is, if the company business is not money lending, then why the company has given loan to a shareholder? It means, by instead of paying dividend distribution tax, company has made a donation to give a loan. Such loan is also called as the deemed dividend under section 222E, is the conclusion. And the thing to be remembered here again is, this is deemed dividend under 222E is applicable only for closely held company, that means unlisted companies, that means company in which public is not substantially interested. I have already clarified it in beginning of this today's session itself. And coming to third point, a shareholder who has 10% voting power, if the shareholder expenses have been spent by the company, for example, if shareholder is to pay LIC premium of 50,000, this LIC premium is paid by company. If this LIC premium is paid by the company, that means shareholder who has 10% voting power, if his personal expenses were spent by company, that is also called as the, if company pays this LIC premium of 50,000 on behalf of the shareholder who has 10% voting power, this is also called as deemed dividend, which is taxable, on which 30% tax is payable by the company. So many of the companies might not check this option, but this is very, very valuable option, section 222E. If they do not check this at the time of scrutiny, we are going to face a huge concern. Here 30% tax will get attracted. If company business itself is a money lending business, here we have learnt an exception. Company business is not money lending, then what is the intention of the company is, instead of paying dividend, it has given loan. On such loan, 30% tax will get attracted. So coming to a conclusion, 222A to 222D, 15% dividend distribution tax, 12% surcharge, 4% cess. Okay, this is to be calculated on gross dividend. Okay, now coming to 222E, special tax at the rate 30%, 12% surcharge, 4% cess. And it is fully exempt in the hands of the shareholders. This dividend distribution tax is to be paid on net dividend only. This need not be grossed up. Generally, this dividend shall be grossed up 100/85. But this deemed dividend under 222E need not be grossed up, is the conclusion. So I think this provision of 222E is very clear. And now here we have another deemed dividend. So general dividend received by a company. This we have already discussed in first chapter basic concepts, that if Indian company invests in a foreign company covering a capital of at least 26%, in such a case, this foreign company is called as specified foreign company. if Indian company invests 26% of the capital in a foreign company, such company is called as specified foreign company. Any dividend received by this Indian company out of such foreign company, a special tax rate at the rate 15% is liable to be paid. Generally, in case of companies, if they write this foreign company dividend under a head income from other sources, company is generally liable to pay 30% or 25% tax rates. Instead of paying such normal tax of 30%, a lower tax rate of 15% has been suggested here. Who has to invest? Indian company. Where it has to invest? In foreign company. How much it need to invest? 26%. Now, what the company is required to receive? Dividend. Which dividend is taxable out of demerit dividend, normal dividend and demerit dividend? Both the things we have focused. And coming to casual incomes. Casual incomes were liable to pay tax at the rate 30%. If on winning from lottery of 1 crore, but they are going to give me a check for 70 lakhs only. But we have to tax income from other sources 70 lakhs into 100 by 70. 100 lakhs, that means 1 crore should be shown as income from other sources. Gross winnings is taxable under the head income from other sources, not net winnings. The thing we are going to give clarification here is the gross dividend is taxable, not the net dividend. Okay. So gross income is taxable. Okay. So let me come to a conclusion here that the casual incomes, horse races, crossword puzzles, lottery income, card games, here special tax rate at the rate 30% and health and education says at the rate 4%. Straight away we can calculate. Actually, education says 2%, health and education says 1%, and along with that, in order to provide medical facilities, this is secondary and higher education says, health facilities 1% is been collected. We are aggregating all of them and specifying as 4%, but actually if we need a bifurcation, education says 2%, primary education says, secondary and higher education says 1%. Health says 1%. In total, we are going to straight away specify that health and education says at the rate 4% shall be levied. So, without any reduction of the expenses, even lottery ticket cost also cannot be claimed as expenditure. If I have purchased a lottery ticket for 10,000 and I have won 10 lakhs, 10 lakhs is taxable. Even lottery ticket cost of 10,000 also cannot be claimed as reduction. So, without any reduction, full amount is taxable is the conclusion. Now, coming to fourth point. Interest on enhanced compensation. I have already specified this in charging section 56. Now again I am going to give you a clarification that compensation is taxable under the head capital gains. Interest on compensation is taxable under the head income from other sources with a standard deduction of 50%. Here we can claim a standard deduction of 50% before taxing it under the head income from other sources. A standard deduction irrespective of actual expenditure. If interest on enhanced compensation received is 5 lakhs, then 2.5 lakhs is only taxable. A standard deduction of 50% has been specified in section 57 is the conclusion. Okay. Now in continuation of our discussion, now very very important provision, taxability of gifts. How the gifts were taxable and how much is the exemption given? What are the exceptions in the provisions of gift? So let us have a detailed discussion here, and after this discussion some queries were raised in live chat. I am also going to solve such queries at the end of the session. Now let me continue my discussion with the taxability of gifts. Gifts I have categorized into three parts: cash gift, movable properties and immovable properties, because the limit of 50,000 is applicable for each category. For each category, we can claim the limit of 50,000. So, I have divided the gifts into three categories: cash gift, movable property gift, and immovable property gift. I have categorized them into three parts. Now, coming to discussion, if the cash gift exceeds 50,000. The thing that was specified here is if the cash gift exceeds 50,000 aggregate cash gift, not in a day, the aggregate cash gift received in the year, if it exceeds 50,000, in such a case, entire cash receipts were taxable. For example, on occasion of birthday, if some of the friends have given a gift of 50,000 rupees cash gift, this 50,000 is exempted. But if any other friend has given 100 rupees in extra, which comes to a total of 50,100, then 50,100 is taxable. That means this limit of 50,000 has to be considered. This limit of 50,000 has to be considered in aggregate. If the aggregate cash receipts exceeds 50,000, if aggregate does not exceed 50,000, then it is exempt. But if the aggregate receipts exceeds 50,000, then entire cash receipts would be taxable. Here aggregate receipts should be considered. Okay. Here cash means not only in cash transfer through bank, DD, online transfers, check, Google Pay, Phone Pay transfers, fixed deposits, even NSC transfer is also a gift. Nothing but a cash gift. So finally, if the cash gift received in an annum exceeds 50,000, then it is taxable under the head. Entire income is taxable under the head other sources. Below 50, no tax. Above 50,000, fully taxable is the conclusion. Now coming to second part, movable properties without consideration and inadequate consideration. Sir, movable properties, let me take jewelry as example. If a jewelry whose value is 12 lakhs fair market value has been received by way of gift from a friend, in such a case, this 2 lakhs is taxable under the head income from other sources. This is called without consideration. If the aggregate fair market value, here also we should not consider each property, aggregate of the mobile properties fair market value, if it exceeds 50,000 in a year, then entire amount would be taxable. Here aggregate receipts should be considered is the conclusion. Okay, now coming to second part, inadequate consideration. If 2 lakhs jewelry is given for only 1.2 lakhs, in this case, this difference of 80,000 is the inadequate consideration. If such difference has exceeded 50,000, here difference has exceeded 50,000, this 80,000 would be taxable under the head income from other sources. So I think this provision is very clear. So here aggregate receipts, not each mobile property, aggregate mobile properties has to be considered. If aggregate receipts without consideration has exceeded 50,000, then the entire amount is taxable. Inadequate consideration, difference amount is only taxable. So I think this provision of movable properties is very clear. Now coming to last part, immovable properties. Sir, immovable property each has to be considered. Mobile properties and cash gift aggregate we have considered, but here for each property, if each property stamp duty value exceeds 50,000, if immovable properties were received by way of gift without consideration or inadequate consideration, the thing we have received here is immovable properties. If a land or building is given by a friend by way of a gift, in such a case, if the land value is 1 lakh, then 1 lakh is taxable under the head income from other sources. If two lands were given as gift, land 1 whose stamp duty value is 40,000, land 2 whose stamp duty value is 40,000, even though aggregate has exceeded 50,000, nothing is chargeable under the head income from other sources, because each property should be considered. Here we have the term aggregate, here we have the term aggregate, but in case of immovable properties, we need to consider each immovable property is the conclusion. And in case of inadequate consideration, inadequate portion, that means difference, the stamp duty value and actual consideration difference, if it exceeds 50,000, and also 5% of inadequate portion. Last session we have discussed section 50C, 5% variation permissible. And in 43CA, PGBP also we have discussed that 5% different is permissible. Like that, in the same way, here also we have a provision of 5% permissible variation. Let me clear this with an example. If the stamp duty value is 1 or 2 lakhs, but I have purchased the property for 100 lakhs, that means here inadequate consideration is to the extent of 2 lakhs. Whether this 2 lakhs is taxable in the hands of buyer? Answer is no, because even though this inadequate portion has exceeded 50,000, it has not exceeded 5% of the actual consideration. Here actual consideration is 100 lakhs. 5% of actual consideration means 5 lakhs. It has to not only exceed 50,000, the gift amount, the inadequate portion should exceed 5% of the actual consideration also. That means if this difference is only 5% or less, then the provisions of gift is not applicable. Provisions of gift will be applicable only in a case where the inadequate portion, sir, without consideration there is no doubt, if the stamp duty value exceeds 50,000, it is taxable. But in case of inadequate portion, the difference should also exceed not only 50,000 but also 5%. When these both conditions were satisfied, then only it is taxable under the head income from other sources. And here the thing I have already given you a clarification that each property has to be considered. In first two cases, cash and mobile properties, we have considered aggregate, but coming to immobile properties, each property has to be considered. Okay, now let me give an example. If you answer this example, then the gift provision you were very clear. Now coming to this, here I have given so that it would be very easy. Rather than discussing an example, this would be very easy. 50,000 limit is for each category. 50,000 limit is for each category. Now let me give an example. If you understand this example, the provisions as of now what I have discussed shall be very clear to you. Here we have 5 categories of gifts. Number 1, cash gift. Number 2, mobile property without consideration. Number 3, mobile property inadequate consideration. Number 4, immobile property without consideration. Number 5, immobile property inadequate consideration. If in each category I have received a gift of 40,000 rupees, if in each category I have received a gift of 40,000 rupees, now whether the provisions of gift will get attracted is the question. In this case, the limit of 50,000 in aggregate, here we have received a gift of 2 lakhs, but the limit of 50,000 should not be aggregated for all the categories. Each category we have a limit of 50,000. Since under each category, the gift amount has not exceeded 50,000, nothing is taxable. So this is the point I need to get clarified to you. The limit of 50,000 should be applied for each of the above categories is the conclusion. So I think this provision is very clear. And if gift is received from employer, this concept is different. In salary chapter I have already discussed that. Gift from employer, cash gift fully taxable. Gift in kind, below 5,000 nothing is taxable. Above 5,000 value of gift is fully taxable. I have already given clarification this in the head salary. Gift from employer, cash gift fully taxable. Gift in kind, if it exceeds 5,000, then it is taxable is the conclusion. So I think these provisions of gift were very clear. But the provisions of gift has certain exceptions. That means even though the gift amount has exceeded 50,000, nothing is taxable. The first thing that was specified here is gift from any relative. Gift from any relative. Gift from relatives is not taxable at all. Cash gift, mobile property, immobile property, whatever may be, gift from relatives is not at all taxable. Here we need to learn definition of the term relative. What do you mean by the term relative? I have presented a family chart here for the purpose of our interpretation. For easy interpretation, I have presented a chart on definition of the term family. If individual receives gifts from this chart, but from any person, if this individual receives the gift, then it is not taxable. Even though the gift amount has exceeded 50,000, nothing is taxable. So here the thing to be noted is, if individual receives gift from his spouse, mother, father, sister or brother, these are all the first relatives of the persons. So individual, if he receives gift from father or mother, nothing is taxable. Father's brother and his spouse, father's sister and spouse, if this individual receives from this relatives also, if this individual receives cash gift from father's brother or father's brother's spouse, then the gift received is not taxable at all. So this is the family chart you need to know here. You can take a screenshot or else you can remember, it's very easy. In case of individual, if gift is received from a mother or mother's brother and spouse, mother's sister and spouse is also been included in definition of the term relative. Sir, here we are defining the term relative. The concept of interpretation of relative is, individual, if he receives gift from relative, is not taxable, is the exception given in section 56. That exception one, now we are going to learn in an easy manner. An individual, sister and brother, both and along with their spouse is also our relatives. If we are going to receive gift from brother's spouse or sister's spouse, this is also exempted. Nothing is taxable. So here taxability arises. Sir, here I am going to specify you from recipient point of view. If individual receives, not gives. If individual gives gift, you have to interpret it from recipient point of view. So I am not going to discuss about donor. I am going to discuss about recipient of the gift only. If gift is received from this relatives, then it is exempted. Now coming to individual, if gift is received from spouse, it is exempt. Spouse, father, at the time of marriage or later during festivals also, generally spouse, father gives certain gold or cash gift to this individual. This is exempted. So spouse, father or spouse, mother, if they give any cash gift or mobile or immobile property as gift to individual, this is not taxable. Even spouse, sister and spouse, brother, if any gift has received, nothing is taxable in the hands of the individual. Now coming to below, individual daughter and spouse, individual son and his spouse, if any gift has been received, this is also exempted. Sir, everything if you see here, the arrow mark is presented towards individual. If you see, all the arrow marks were presented towards individual. That means, if individual receives the gifts from those persons, sir, here spouse, father, spouse, mother need not give gift to spouse. Even though spouse, father directly gives gift to individual also, it is exempted. Just to understand, I have made arrow mark to spouse, but here the meaning is, if the gift received by individual, it is not taxable at all. Here we have clearly presented the chart of individual. Now coming to second part, in case of HUF, all the members were relatives. In case of HUF, the term relative means all the members shall be treated as relatives in case of HUF. So if HUF gives gift to members or members give gift to HUF, nothing is taxable under the head income from other sources because it has been excluded. Okay. Now coming to individual, if an individual receives a gift from his grandfather, if individual receives a gift from his grandfather, whether is it taxable? No, because any linear ascendant, father, grandfather, great-grandfather, mother, grandmother, great-grandmother, whatever may be, all the linear ascendants have been included here. All the linear ascendants were relatives. And gift received from son, grandson, great-grandson, whatever may be. So here, any linear descendant is also relative. Any linear ascendant and any linear descendant, both were considered in the definition of the term relative. I think this provision is very clear. So gift received from which person is taxable, which person is not taxable, I have given you a clarification. Let me continue my discussion. Exception number one, gift received from a relative is exempted. Exception number one, gift received from relative is exempted. And gift received on the occasion of marriage, if friends give a cash gift of rupees 1 lakh on the occasion of marriage, even though they are not relatives, gift received on the occasion of marriage is fully exempted. It has been excluded from gift provisions. So the thing that was specified here is on the occasion of marriage, not on the occasion of marriage anniversary. Gift received on account of marriage anniversary is taxable. Gift received on account of marriage anniversary is taxable from non-relatives. Gift received on the occasion of marriage is only exempted. Sir, if he is going to do his second marriage, second, third, whatever may be, so on any marriage, first, second, third has not been specified in this provisions of gift. So on the occasion of marriage has been specified here, not marriage anniversary. So on the occasion of marriage, if SSE receives any gift, such gift is completely exempted. And any gift received by way of will or inheritance or in contemplation of death of a payer, if Mr. A has sister, if upon death of his sister, the properties of sister were received by his brother due to non-existence of any other relatives, if properties of sister comes to brother, this is called as in contemplation of death of a payer, this is also exempted. And gift received from a trust, gift received from the trust, because trust, if it spends for non-charitable purpose, it is going to pay tax. And hence, any scholarship or amount received from trust, gift provisions will not get attracted. Even 1023C, we are going to discuss it in assessment of trust. So hospitals and education institutions, if they are going to give any scholarships, it is also exempted. Okay. So any individual created by trust, the same thing that was specified here also. So let me come to a conclusion that these exceptions were very, very important practically and also for examination purpose. If an item is not covered in exception, then only it is taxable. Okay. So now I will give you one example for interpretation of this gift provision. This is very, very important. If I am going to give you a gift, if I am going to give a bench car whose value is 50 lakhs to you, if I am going to give a bench car as gift to you, whether you are liable, because donor is not the criteria, the person who is receiving the gift has to offer the income under the head income from other sources. If I am going to give gift to you a car, a bench car whose market value is 50 lakhs, whether you are liable to pay tax by offering the income under the head income from other sources. Just think of a while. If I give a gift of a motor car with a fair market value of 50 lakhs as gift to you, you are not my relative. And whether the gift value of 50 lakhs is taxable in your hands is the question. So many might think that this is taxable, but this is not taxable. This is not taxable. If I am going to give a bench car as gift to you, whether are you liable to pay any tax on fair market value on 50 lakhs under the head income from other sources? Answer is no. Sir, why you are saying it as no? The fair market value, car is a movable property. The fair market value has exceeded 50 lakhs and hence it is taxable. No, it is not taxable, because now let me come to the subject. Very, very important concept we are discussing here. Now let me come to the subject. Here the thing that was specified here in gift is we have to give movable property as gift. Yes, car is movable, but we need to learn definition of the term property. This term is very important. Only the things which were defined in the term property is given by way of gift whose value exceeds 50,000, then only it is taxable. If an item is not specified in property definition, if that item I am going to give you a gift, then nothing is taxable. Taxability arises only when the term which was specified in definition of the term property. Sir, I have given an example of motor car. If I have given motor car to you, whether are you liable to pay tax? Answer is no. You need not pay motor tax, tax on this motor vehicle, because if you come to definition of the term property, if you come to definition of the term property, the thing that was specified here is immobile property. If land or building has been given by way of gift, then it is taxable. Shares, jewelry, archaeological collections, bullion, drawings, paintings, sculptures, work of art. Motor car has not been given. If I am going to give a laptop of 70,000 as a gift to you, I am going to give a laptop 70,000 fair market value as gift to you. Whether are you liable to pay tax on the 70,000? Answer is no, because laptop is not a property. Section 56 in property definition, the thing that was specified here is the list does not contain car, laptop, cell phone. If a cell phone whose value is 1 lakh has given gift to you, if I have given a gift of 1 lakh mobile phone to you, whether are you liable to pay tax under income from other sources? No, because the things which were covered in property definition, if they were gifted, then only the tax liability arises. I think this point is very clear. Every gift is not taxable. Cash gift, mobile property gift, immobile property gift. We have to learn the definition of the term property first. When any item which is not defined in the term property is given by way of gift, then nothing is taxable, is the conclusion. So I think this provision is very clear. Now coming to TDS implications on transfer of immobile property. So let me come to straight away that point, that TDS implication under 194IA TDS implication. Actually, in case of immobile property, if the value exceeds 50,000 stamp, the consideration exceeds 50 lakhs, in such a case, 1% TDS has to be deducted. I will present you this concept of 194IA in next chapter. We have separate discussion in one day regarding the concept of TDS and TCS. Here I will give you a clarification again. So let me conclude here that if immobile property value exceeds 50 lakhs, then TDS will also get attracted. 1% is the thing to be noted here. Okay. Now coming to immobile property in hands of seller, in hands of buyer. Immobile property, that means nothing but a land and building. Sir, this chart is very important. Now we are going to link three sections, 43CA, 50C and 56 subsection 2, clause 10. These three sections we are going to learn in common. In hands of the seller, if land and building is held as stock in trade, 43CA applies. If land or building is sold at a price less than the stamp duty value, then stamp duty value is considered as the full value of consideration. A minimum variation of 5% is permissible. This I have already discussed in the chapter PGBP. And coming to second part, if land and building is held as a capital asset, then section 50C applies. Here also the same thing, 5% variation is permissible. If it exceeds, then while offering income under the head capital gains, stamp duty value is to be considered. These two things I have already considered it under the head PGBP and capital gains. Now coming to other sources, in hands of buyer, if the difference, this 50 lakhs is TDS, this concept is different. If in hands of buyer, 110 lakhs stamp duty value of property is purchased for 100 lakhs, in hands of seller, we are going to take 110 lakhs as the full value of consideration. And in hands of buyer, this difference of 10 lakhs, it has exceeded 50,000 and it has also exceeded 5% of consideration. In this case, this 10 lakhs is taxable under the head income from other sources. Sir, this chart is not a new thing. This is a revision of the concepts which were discussed earlier. Okay. Now, the stamp duty value on the date of agreement or on the date of registration. If any part of the consideration is paid by way of account pay check, DD or ECS at the time of agreement, then stamp duty value on the date of agreement should be considered. If it was not paid at the time of agreement or not paid by way of account pay check, DD or ECS, then stamp duty value on the date of registration is to be considered, because the stamp duty value may differ from the date of agreement to the date of registration. In this case, the thing that was specified is, even though the stamp duty value might differ, whether agreement has to be considered, registration has to be considered, depends upon the payment made. If the payment is made by way of account pay check, DD or ECS on the date of agreement, then stamp duty value is to be considered at the time of agreement, or else the stamp duty value on the date of registration is to be considered, is the conclusion. Okay. Now coming to balance topic, section 57. Not only incomes, we have certain deductions, like in PGBP we have discussed it, section 37, like that we have here section 57. The thing that was discussed here is, in case of dividends, foreign company dividends, any realization expenses can be claimed as expenditure. In case of interest on securities, any bank charges incurred can be claimed as expenditure. Okay. And in case of employee provident funds, if you remember, if employee's contribution is paid within the due date of respective acts, PF and ESA act, then only it is eligible as deduction. If you are not going to pay it, you have to offer it as income. We have already discussed this in today's session also. In beginning we have discussed it. Okay. Next, where the income is from hiring of machinery, plant and furniture, then depreciation, current repairs, okay, depreciation, insurance premium can be claimed as expenditure. Inseparable portion, if you remember, entire thing is taxable under the head income from other sources, where we can claim current repairs, insurance premium and normal depreciation as the expenditure. And this is very important aspect, family pension, 1/3 of the pension or 15,000, whichever is less, can be claimed as deduction. Upon death of employee, if employee family members receives pension, out of such pension, 1/3 of the pension can be claimed as deduction, or maximum 15,000, whichever is lower. Okay. And any other expenditure, whatever may be, which was wholly and exclusively incurred for earning income, if you incur any other expenditure, it can be claimed as deduction under section 57, is the conclusion. So I think same like 37, here we have section 57. Okay. Now coming to the next concept, amounts which are not deductible, personal expenses cannot be claimed as deduction. And if any interest is payable outside India, TDS has to be deducted. If TDS is not deducted on payment to a non-resident, then no expenditure can be claimed as deduction. That means nothing but 100% disallowance. And if we are going to pay any salary expense outside India also, TDS has to be deducted. If TDS is not deducted, then it is taxable. Taxes cannot be claimed as deduction, and this is very important aspect, 40A will get attracted. That means cash payment in excess of 10,000 in a day cannot be made, not only under the head PGBP 40A3, 40A3 disallowance is applicable for income from other sources also, very important. And no deduction out of the casual incomes. We have already noted that no deduction can be claimed out of the casual incomes. And coming to the next thing, deemed income. If the expenditure allowed, same we have discussed that in PGBP, bad debts can be claimed as expenditure under section 56. And if that bad debts were future realized, then it is a deemed income under section 41. In the same way, if any expenditure which was claimed as deduction under section 57, which was recovered later, in future if we are going to receive, then it is called as deemed income. Like PGBP section 41, here we have section 59 as the deemed income. So this provision is very clear. And we have two more provisions in a concept of income from other sources, dividend stripping and bonus stripping. So dividend stripping means, if the company, one example will solve all your queries regarding dividend stripping. Record date means the dividend declaration date by the company. Record date, for example, if this is the record date, 23rd December 2019 is the record date. If any shares were purchased within 3 months from record date, that means in this gap, from 23rd September 2019 to 20th, sir, this is just an example. This is not the dates which were given in the section. This is an example only, okay? So 23rd December 2019 is the record date. Within 3 months, if you have purchased any shares in this gap, 1000 shares were purchased for 150 for 1,50,000, okay? This is cum dividend price. This is cum dividend price. And hence, on record date, if we are going to receive a dividend of 20 per share, 20 per share into 1000, 20,000 is exempted under 1034. And after record date, if the shares were sold within 3 months, and in case of mutuals and mutual funds, if they were sold within 9 months, for example, between these two dates, if the shares were sold within 3 months, and mutual funds, if they were sold within 9 months, for 1 lakh in my example, actually, at the time of purchase, we have spent 1,50,000. At the time of sale, we have sold only for 1 lakh. That means here there is a short-term capital loss of 50,000. But this is not the correct short-term capital loss, because this is the cum dividend price and this is the ex-dividend price. Both cum dividend and ex-dividend cannot be compared for computing short-term capital loss. And hence, out of the short-term capital loss, the dividend received should be excluded, and the net short-term capital loss 30 lakhs can only be carry forwarded is the conclusion. So I think this provision is very clear. Normally, if this concept of dividend stripping is not specified, 50,000 shall be treated as short-term capital loss. But cum dividend price and ex-dividend price and its comparability should not decide the loss. And so the conclusion that was given is, out of the short-term capital loss, the dividend received should be excluded is the conclusion. Okay. Next, simply if we speak section 94, this is section 94, subsection 7, deemed dividend, dividend stripping. Short-term capital loss should be ignored to the extent of the dividend received. The thing that was specified here is, short-term capital loss should be ignored to the extent of the dividend received. Okay. Because when this concept is applicable, if purchase has been made within 3 months of record date and sale has been made within 3 months after record date, and in case of shares, if it was made within 9 months, then the concept of dividend stripping attracts. I think this provision is very clear. Now, this is the last concept that we are going to discuss, and then let me go for queries. Coming for bonus stripping. Sir, what do you mean by the term bonus stripping? Bonus stripping is applicable only for mutual funds and UTI units. Bonus stripping is not applicable for shares. If you refer here, dividend stripping is applicable for shares and units, but bonus stripping is not applicable for shares and units. Here, in this case, the thing that was specified here is the record date. The record date, same, within 3 months if we are going to purchase, and within 9 months, since only units were specified here, if the sale has been made within 9 months. But here we are not going to receive dividend. On record date, if we receive any bonus units, earlier, if we are going to receive dividend, out of short-term capital loss, we are going to reduce the dividend received. But here, this loss of 50,000 to be treated as cost of acquisition of bonus units. Generally, for bonus units and shares, cost of acquisition is zero. But if this is made out of this bonus stripping, then in this case, the thing that was specified here is the loss to be treated as cost of acquisition of the bonus units. I have also presented this in capital gains chapter. Bonus shares allotted before 1/4/2001, fair market value on 1/4/2001 is the cost of acquisition. Last day, capital gains chart this was. Bonus shares allotted on or after 1/4/2001, cost of acquisition is zero. But here I have a para, last session I have not discussed this. In case of mutual fund, if any short term capital loss is incurred and any bonus issue is made on record date, such short term capital loss should be treated as cost of acquisition of the bonus units. Short term capital loss should be treated as cost of acquisition of bonus units is the conclusion. So I think this provision of bonus stripping is also clear. So by this we have completed the discussion on complete discussion on income from other sources. Okay. So now let me solve the queries that were raised in live chat. Coming to the discussion, the first thing that was question here today is, sir, discuss intraday trading and futures and options. Yes, sure, sir. We'll discuss in assessment of other persons at a later point of time. So now coming to here, the first question, gift by resident brother to his NRI brother, amount $2,51,000, is taxable in the hands of NRI brother. Okay, sir, gift provisions I have discussed in day one, that if a resident gives gift to a non-resident, it is deemed to be accrued in India. In this case, you have asked me the question that one brother is located in India and another brother is located outside India. If a brother in India gives gift to NRI brother, this is called as income deemed to be accrued in India. Yes, it is taxable. But provisions of gift among relatives is generally exempted. Actually, this is, if he is a brother, then nothing will get taxed. But here, the thing that was specified here is, in section 56, in order to get taxed, they must be received from non-relative. Here, brother, if he is a cousin, then it may be taxable. If it is direct, his own brother, then nothing shall be taxable. I think this provision is very clear. Next, a gift by HUF to its members is taxable. No. A gift by private trust to its beneficiary is taxable. Sir, private trust we will discuss in assessment of trust. Private trust beneficiary hands will be taxable. I will discuss in assessment of trust. So please wait for a while. Next, 50% of interest. Yes, we can claim it as deduction, standard deduction. Yes, interest on enhanced compensation, 50% standard deduction. Individual can accept gift from relatives more than 2 lakhs. Okay, this is a question regarding section 269 ST. Here, there is a question regarding 269 ST. From the past assessment year 1920 onwards, the thing that was specified here is, in respect of an event, aggregate also, 2 lakhs we should not receive from a person in cash. For example, if a friend gives me 3 lakhs cash on the occasion of marriage, this 3 lakhs on the occasion of marriage gift provisions were not applicable. But in excess of 2 lakhs, we should not accept cash from a person on occasion of one event. In excess of 2 lakhs, we should not receive in cash. It has been specified in section 269 ST. So even cash sales, even hospitals also, from patients, no person should receive in excess of 2 lakhs in respect of an invoice. Not only in a day. For example, 5 lakhs is the sale invoice. Per day, if he is going to receive 1 lakh in cash, this is also a violation as per section 269 ST. Equal to the amount of cash received, we are liable to pay penalty. So rather than paying penalty, even gift also in excess of 2 lakhs, we should not receive in cash is the conclusion. Okay. Next, if company distributed redeemable preference shares at a later point of time, whether which amount to dividend? Yes, at the time of allotment itself, I have specified it as a deemed dividend. At the time of redemption again, it shall not be taxable. Okay. Next, whether unlisted government company is a closely held company. Yes, all the unlisted companies were closely held companies. But generally, government companies were separate. Government companies do not distribute the dividend to the directors because it requires the approval of the government. So generally, it shall be excluded from definition of the term closely held company. Okay. Next, whether section 185 is applicable. We shall discuss in assessment of AOP. Okay. Next, dividend received from mutual fund which investing in foreign company, whether is it taxable? Yes, dividend from Indian mutual funds only exempt under 1035. Dividend received from foreign mutual funds were taxable under the head income from other sources. Okay. If person receives 2 lakhs lottery and has no other income, whether he can claim basic exemption? No. 2 lakhs lottery received, tax at the rate 30% should be paid. No reliefs and no rebates. Even 87A rebate is also not applicable from, not eligible from casual incomes. Okay. Next, if in a closely held company fair market value is negative and face value is 10, then whether it can be issued at par? Yes, sir. If you are going to issue at par, then you are not going to attract gift provisions. Number one, it has to be issued at premium, and the premium should exceed the fair market value. Then it is taxable under the head income from other sources. Okay. So if you issue at par, then nothing shall be taxable. Only securities premium, then the fair market value in excess of the fair allotment price shall be taxable is the conclusion. Okay. Next, Flipkart, Amazon vouchers are also cash gift. Yes, the vouchers were also cash gifts only. Yes, sir. Stamp duty value means, stamp duty value is different from sale consideration. Okay. Next, no minimum sales value as per revenue authority. Minimum value is not the consideration. 50,000 is the limit that was imposed in other sources. Can individual give gift to father's brother? Sir, giving of gift is not the criteria. Receiving of gift is the criteria. If individual gives gift to father's brother, from that father's brother point of view, you are not the relative. Hence, for them the tax liability might arise. So you have to check from your point of view, the recipient point of view, you have to check whether it is taxable or not. Okay. Next, if a car purchased by A and gifted, I have already presented to you, car is not a property and hence nothing taxability arises. If minor receives gift, okay, if it exceeds 50,000, should be clubbed in the hands of the parents whose income is higher. Ex gratia from government is an exempted income. Actually, it's a gift, but it's an exempted income. Exempted income is not taxable. Next, sir, gift received from stepchildren, whether is it taxable? Yes, children were exempted, but not stepchildren. They were taxable. Next. If the company has taken over lenders under bankruptcy provision, how shareholders receive to book the losses? That's a company's account treatment. This is not the criteria from taxation point of view. Even though the company is in liquidation process, the fair market value, we have to check to the extent of accumulated profit under 222C, company is liable to pay dividend distribution tax. And in excess of that deemed dividend, shareholder, last session we have discussed that capital gain tax liability arises. Next, is TDS deducted on maturity of life insurance? I will discuss at a later point of time. Maturity, TDS, 1010D exemption is eligible. If 1010D exemption is not eligible, 5% TDS will be deducted. Okay. Sir, son received gold from father worth 75 lakhs. Is it taxable? No. At the time of sale by son, it is taxable. But father, when he has given gift to son, gift from relatives is not taxable. Sir, if loans received from relatives, shall we must compulsory charge interest and TDS accordingly related party transaction? Okay. So interest charging is not the criteria. Here it's a general question that was asked here. It is upon the discretion to you whether you charge the interest or not. If you charge the interest, then interest is taxable. Okay. Next, the company has sold out, whether carry forward of losses can be adjusted? No. Next, sir, can we receive gold as unsecured loan? The thing is not clear here. Gold, if it was received as unsecured loan, then what is the question? If any gold is received as unsecured loan, then the question is not clear. The provisions of gift, whether it will get attracted is yes. But if it was borrowed as a loan, then the provisions of gift will not get attracted. Can HUF give gift to members? Yes, nothing is taxable. Next, can company reimburse tour and travelling expenses of director for business promotion? Yes, that reimbursement is not taxable perquisite at all in hands of employee also. Next, sir, please kindly share PPT of your seminar. Sir, in description box, I think today I have not presented it. I will also present it at a later point of time. In description box, if you refer yesterday video or day before yesterday video, in description box we have a WhatsApp number. If you contact that number, we shall provide the list of our publications so that you can purchase them. Okay. Next, if distribution of assets is In composition, both cash and investments, 222E will get attracted. Okay, sir, 222E to the extent of accumulated profits only. You try to present the question in an easy manner so that I can understand that. On death of wife, can husband inherit the jewelry of wife? Yes. What is the document? Document is not required. Your marriage certificate itself is the proof that they were in marital relationship, and hence nothing, no other document is required in this case. Okay. So many have given compliments here. Thank you. Thank you very much. Next, whether Section 222 Income Tax Act and Section 185 Companies Act were one and the same? No, we should not relate both Companies Act and Income Tax Act. Companies Act, at the time of presentation of statements, at the time of Companies Act compliance, you have to check it. It need not be compared with income tax provisions. Both were different from each other. Okay. Next, taxability, shares received less than fair market value. Less than fair market value, then nothing is taxable. Only if in excess of fair market value company has issued shares, then only it is taxable under the head income from other sources. Interest on loan against FD income, is it an allowable expense? No. Sir, if you FD interest is taxable under the head other sources, interest on FD loan cannot be claimed as deduction, because expense incurred for earning income should be claimed as deduction. This interest expense is not for earning FD interest. If you have borrowed FD loan and used it for business, then interest on FD loan can be claimed as expense under the head PGBP. So I think this provision is very clear. Next. If Amazon voucher, yes sir, Amazon voucher is also cash gift. Okay. Next. Sir, a person can accept less than 2 lakhs from 5 relatives during the year. Cash gift aggregate we need to consider. If each relative given 40,000 each into 5, 2 lakhs, it is taxable, because for each category the limit of 50,000 has to be implemented. So 5 lakhs, 5 relatives, each contributing 40,000 cash gift is also taxable. Okay. Next, sir, if gift is received from adopted children, okay, adopted children is nothing but own children only now, legal representatives only, and hence gift is not taxable. Sir, gift is received from, okay, can employee pay director income tax 60,000 from his online account? This is a perquisite. Perquisites were different from gifts. If tax of employee is paid by company, it is taxable in the hands of director under the head salary. So we are not going to consider it an income from other sources. Okay. Next, advance if repaid. Advance, just a minute. Advance if repaid by 31st March, whether 222 attracts. Yes, repayment of loan is not the criteria. If company grants the loan to a shareholder who is having minimum 10% voting power, it is called as deemed dividend. In this case, repayment is not the criteria. Okay, next. Whether shares issued for inadequate consideration, what happens in the hands of allottee? Yes, in a difference between the fair market value and actual consideration, if it exceeds 50,000 in the hands of recipient, income from other sources, it is taxable. Next, loan given to a director whose voting power is more than 10% and repaid the same. Sir, the thing I am going to give you clarification is repayment is not the criteria. Income Tax Act is questioning why you have given loan. Your business is not money lending business. Then why you have given loan? It is nothing but dividend. You need to pay 30% tax. Further repayment is not the criteria. The company should not give loan at all. This is what the thing to be noted, not the repayment. Okay. Next. When shares issued for inadequate. Okay, I have already solved this. Sir, if gift one individual to another individual 1 lakh in both hands, whether it is taxable or not. Donor hands, it is not taxable. Gift is taxable in the hands of recipient only. If it exceeds 50,000, then it is taxable. A land of value 2 crores gifted to unrelated on his marriage, is it taxable? No. But you need to prove that land of 2 crores is given on the occasion of marriage only. For this purpose, gift deed is compulsory. If in registration document, if you clearly specify that on the occasion of marriage, this gift has been made, if gift deed is registered, then it is exempted. No problem. Okay. Next. Okay, that's it. So, compliment was received. Thank you. Thank you very much for your compliments. So by this, we have completed income from other sources today. So If anyone requires material, you can contact the WhatsApp number in description box. Last yesterday or day before yesterday video we have, and today's video also I shall present it at a later point of time. So by this we have completed our discussion. So one question, brokerage paid on hundi loans can be allowed as an expense? Yes, interest and brokerage paid can be claimed as expenditure. Any expenditure incurred for earning the income can be claimed. Okay, so by this we are going to conclude the session, and tomorrow very very important aspect, deductions under chapter 6A, 80C to 80U, I have divided into 26 categories for you for a easy presentation, and very very important amendments 80EEA, EEB, the new sections were added in deductions chapter. Those we are going to discuss in tomorrow's session. So by this we are going to conclude today's session. Thank you. Thank you very much.